A short introduction about me. My name is Björn Schießle. I'm a senior software engineer at Nextcloud. I work on open-source technology now for over 4 years. As Frank said, this introduction also came up with an idea together with about 3.5 years ago. Over the years, I've worked in many areas. I've worked on the normal side stuff, on version, on the client side, the server side encryption, and of course, on the configuration stuff, which I've So, let's start with a short introduction on what is cloud configuration. When we started developing Nextcloud and we set up both the cloud solution, we had in mind, first time in mind, we want to provide you something where you have control over your data, where you can install your own server, your own machine, in your company, in your education institute, or just at home. And then you have the data, then you know where the data is, you know who has access to it, and you can control it with software, because I think this is open source, open software. And over time, when the developers and teams start using this, we discovered one drawback, and this is this approach to create high isolates. Because in the worst case, you could say that everybody has a small box at home, and then in this box there is maybe only one user, you alone, and then you put it in the for your company, it's just your employees. But of course, you want to share the files and work together with people, also have their own Nextcloud installation or one different research institute or a different company. So we had to find a way to connect them somehow. And that's the whole idea about cloud collaboration can listen to it. So we thought about a solution to connect this thing with the next cloud again, so that you can then share with the people the files and also work together on files as seamlessly as all people in the same server. So in the TDS solution, you would have any different routes, any different the people is on the same server or it's on a different server. We are already achieved, but of course there are still errors that we can improve to make this more seamlessly, and this is something I want to talk about here in this talk. We also work together in the cloud branch on this idea, this topic technology. Here is Nextcloud showing this group of people who drive this federation stuff over 2016. But of course, most of us who developed this were members of this cloud mesh initiative right from the beginning, just as it were other company, and now the next part will show them, of course, again, because we want to continue to work with them on this technology to drive it forward and to develop it also as a standard to a stage where everybody can use it also across different cloud solutions. And already today, as already said by Frank, we have at least three software solutions implemented this in the cloud in the API. This is Nextcloud, of course. This is own cloud and the video solution. So we already have three across three different products. So I want to go a little bit about the current state of my cloud sharing. So everything I taught you in this part of the talk is already available in place. So you can follow the next time you can already use all this functionality I showed you. When we started developing this federated cloud stuff, we started with the most obvious thing, and this is we always had a possibility to send people to create a share link for a file or folder and send it to people via email or in a different way. And people could open this in a browser and see the files or photo shared with them. And there we had it just on the top right a button to share with your add to your Nextcloud. There are people who also have a Nextcloud somewhere else. Can click the button, enter the federated cloud ID, and then this gets added to their own Nextcloud as a web platform. That's the technology behind it. At the beginning, this was directly created as a web platform when you click on it. Now, since Nextcloud app, we ask then the server who has the files to create a real federated share with me. This has the advantage for the owner of the file that he can see every person who mounts this stuff in you, and also can adjust the permissions and stuff like this, and can also remove them again. Because this, at some point, many people share stuff in you, it doesn't want it anymore, that remove all the people or something like that. And also, if you just remove the public thing, the mounts will still exist. So you can also, as an ownership, by the side, at some point, okay, I don't want to have this public link anymore. But I still want that the people who add it to their own Nextcloud can still use this in their own Nextcloud. So this gives you more flexibility, and this is something which was added now to the Nextcloud category.
Yeah, so you're correct in saying I share a public page and somebody has a search as a federated share, and I can then remove that federated share from my existing system.
Exactly. Exactly. The user then sees the share list, and he sees the federated the public link, and the federated share you mark. And then I can change the permissions for you, or I can remove the link, and you will keep the file, or I can remove you and link this later. So I have, as an owner, I see who has access to the file, and I have complete control over it. And then the second step, of course, was to integrate this deeper into the internal shell dialog of Nextcloud. So after we have implemented this add to the Nextcloud button on the public image page, we went on and allowed it to direct in the share dialog, say, okay, I want to share this file or this folder with this or that user. Also, if it is on a different Nextcloud. And therefore, we invited this federated cloud ID, which is quite similar to the email address, which has the user app and then the server where the next level is installed. So you can enter this here in the share dialog, and then you can share the file with the user wherever it's located. And the nice thing about this is also that you have the same behavior as local shares, so you have exactly the same permissions. This also changed here, because at the beginning, when people just put on the public view, there would be just two options. For the public view, it's read only what you write. But internal shares has more permissions, for example, you can allow them to reshare it and stuff like this. And as soon as you try to share this way, then you have also a full set of permissions, so you can also say, he can read it, he can write it, he can reshare it, or whatever, and you will propagate all the permissions to the other server to adhere to it. Of course, what's until now not possible is group shares. You can address a complete group on a different server or something like this. So at the moment it's charged from one server to another server, but that's also something we want to work on, which will come later in this talk. And then the next thing we developed was if we had all these two parts in place, then we realized that sometimes it can become complicated to find people, because somehow you need to know their shared cloud ID. So someone needs to tell you, okay, this is my cloud ID, you can share something. And we already did some auto-completion. For example, if you had a context app enabled, then you could actually context the cloud ID and you could find it there. But otherwise, it was not possible. Especially for large institutes, which were quite distributed, for example, universities, this happens quite often that every university has its own next cloud installation. But they work together very regularly in projects and stuff like this. So they thought that it might be a good idea to somehow exchange the user list so that you can output also if I'm a student or a researcher at a TUP, that I work on a project with someone at the Universal Subclub, that I just can enter his name and find out automatically it's cloud ID and I can share a document with him because I work with him on the same project. And there we introduce this concept of trusted servers. Where we have basically two options. And one option is that in such a setup, the universities would exchange their next cloud server with us manually, and then the admins would add them to this list in the admin settings. And then the next clouds would start communicating with each other and exchange the user lists. So as I said, people can add this list manually. You know, the five universities or partner companies work with just like that, and then they exchange their address books. And but you can also, it's a setting which is by default disabled, but you can enable this. You can also tell your next cloud, every time I create successfully a share with another user, then I add his next cloud as a trusted server. And the same, if I accept for some share, then I add it automatically as a trusted server. So this way, then you can somehow expand the network over time of next cloud's nodes. And then get more and more people to do our completion. So the idea is just to have some organic way or automatic way to expand the network and then to grow more and more next time. But of course, there are also people sometimes have privacy concerns about it. That's why it's considered by default, but I can't deal with it. And as I said, at the moment, in the federal sharing, we do our completion from two sources. One is the context app that's been visited, and you can have your address book in your context. You can add your memory context, and your email address or phone number, you can add a cloud ID. And then you will find this in the shared dialog and then extend it. Just have your name, stuff like this, and the trusted servers, which are connected to you.
If someone shares from their services or actual instance one, I don't want this file, but I don't want this from my instance, or directly from the other instance.
It gets directly from the other instance. So also, if I share the file with three keepers, I share with you, and you with the dynamics tool, for example. You remove it because you don't know the one that he will still have the file, because the connection directly between me and him.
And the file will
also serve directly for myself. So that's the direct connection between the two of us. It was just initiated by you, but the connection gets created directly between the two of us.
How
does
it work
with the sync plan? The sync plan, the shared thing gets mounted as a wrapper to the next cloud, and the sync plan will just detect changes of the file that is in sync plan. There's no difference if I share directly with you or it's a reshare at the end, as no difference at this point. Because all shares are always connected to the owner, and it's a normal webdav amount on your server from the shares you can grab. And since then, we just look at this webdav for the regular and detect changes and then simply change to your desktop.
And
everything you do, yes.
If you not be proxy?
No. I don't know if it would be proxy.
Well, the HTTP connection would be between the sync client and the server hosting client.
So, if you were on the sync client, if we share, whatever you share with you, you're on the sync client, the sync client connects to your server, and then that must talk to the server.
Okay. So, the sync client will always talk to your server, because it's your sync client is connected to your next cloud.
Yeah.
But then, your next cloud will take the file directly from me. This was a really reshare from some of the
proxy.
Yes.
Yeah. You can do it here in a different
way. Right. Yes. That's also something we can improve in the future, when the sync plan is also the way to directly go to the
automatic. Ownership can be easily transferred as well.
At the moment, I mean, we have supply to transfer ownership from files, but the share, I think, as far as I know, can transfer the files. I think internal shares are going to stay, but the shared shares
are going to
be because the ID is different than the user ID change.
The information about who can share which file and who owns the file is not in the file.
It's not what?
It's not. It's, the file doesn't know who is the owner. And who can share me?
That's
in
the database of the
Nextcloud server store. Of course, the Nextcloud server can look up who owns this file. Because we have this file cache in the database where we see the control directly this file is located and who's the owner. But the file as such,
are you planning to merge this external storage up with this federated thing?
At the moment, yeah, I think there are these root keepers. Exactly. At the moment, the connection is created between two users, it's a normal laptop mount. So it's basically the same like a two users to a laptop mount. The two is already the same laptop backend, but of course, there might be more ways to integrate it even more. So now that I gave you a short overview about what you can use as of today with Nextcloud, I want to look a little bit in the future about what we think about the logical next steps and what we're going to achieve in the next few months and maybe years. Some things are really forward looking for something we can do in a few days, but I still want to share the slides. One point is, we want to make every share really first class citizen in Nextcloud. we really want at some point to unleash the, at some point in time, we want to reach the point that you can say it's an internal memory shared for user, just shouldn't make a difference. You just share a file with another user, and you shouldn't care if it's a different server or whatever. So we really want to integrate this as seamlessly as possible. And of course, at the moment, memory sharing is really not in file sync. But as you know, the next time you can do much more. You can have the calendar, you have the contacts. In the future, you can have collaboration, you can have video calls, you can chat with people. And you really want to also move this federation idea beyond just files. And you might want to make it more easy to find people. We have already introduced stuff like this traffic service, but of course, we want to move forward and make it even more easy to find people you want to share. So one idea to move this integration forward is to internally really represent the user and the group always with the full identifier, always group type server or user and server. And first, this would also allow us at some point, this is a huge internal change, because at the moment internal shares to a different user are just identified by user ID. But if everybody is identified by the user ID at the server, in this internal share, and the same for groups, then first we could also do group sharing, because next person could say, hey, this other company or institute today is this group I want to work with, and everybody in this group should get this file, not just the user. And one other really interesting thing, if you really get this done, is that in the long term, you could even think about the people who could be different of the next cloud service. And they would keep all the shares, because in the share table, always you have the complete ID, the complete user ID, and just the next cloud server would decide on demand, hey, now it's an internal share, I can connect directly. And it's an external share, I like to register with the share. And so our vision is that maybe in the future we can move in that far, that you can move people from one server to another, and because of the complete idea, shares that still exist in the world. But of course, this is really a long time machine, which is not a long time machine, so we want to move in this direction. Yes?
That sounds great.
You
need to change the share table, I guess.
Yeah,
it's not a change the file ID.
Yeah, the file ID is it's a lot of changes also in the back end. But we want to move at least this direction. We will see how far we get that. But that's where we're going
to do. Will this be a change to the API or to the next door?
I don't think it has to be the API, because the API is just the rest of course where I say, hey, user at server X want user A at server X want to share a file with user B and server Y, and this will be changed. Maybe, as I said, it's just rough ideas. Maybe it would also need some additional APIs for federated sharing and stuff like that. Then, of course, we would work together with the other software solutions we implemented, also with the Open Cloud Manager and the standard part to really implement the standard. So, we don't want to make anything which is then just done by the next cloud. But if it needs API changes, of course, we want to do one way that everybody can use that. Yes?
I'm asking about
I think that's the option. And I already discussed with Bjorn, he's in there, at least not there at the moment, but he's the manager of the calendar. You talked about the calendar stuff, and of course for context it will be the same. I hope we can get this done relatively fast. I can't say it will be the next 11 or 12, but I think this is something we can achieve in relatively short time. It's not something we really want to keep it done, because it's a natural next step. We want to put in the calendar contact share dialog issues, almost the same as the file share dialog. We want to do the same operations.
I was actually quite surprised that it didn't work, just because it's the same dialog.
Exactly.
Oh, why?
was expected. So the same time, and it works the same way. Of course, there's something more to try for, but that would be. We can send something to this very soon. Then we want to. Of course, we also want to replace all video chat, text chat stuff. I talked a little bit about it before, the SpeedView integration. SpeedView is a WebRTC solution. So at the moment, also SpeedView, you can call people who are on the same server. Or you can send some link to your server to join the call. But you can really say, I want to call a new server on a different server. And there's something also we think about how we could also use for video chat integration. Also, the same kind of cloud ID. So that I can say directly to my conference and go, hey, call Bruce X on server Y, like I share with the file and I have a call. And then the server should get in contact together and exchange the information needed to get the connection for the call. Yes?
Isn't that like something missing here? You have ready characters and so calling. How about texting?
Texting is all, of course also part of it.
That is part of it.
Yes. It should be really a text and a video conference. Yes. We are still sorting some stuff out there about this work project in the future, but of course we want to have the same kind of federation there at some point in time that we have to go to all parts. Yes?
I recently noticed that the sharing from the desktop client does start working on the classic, and will it automatically work with federated instance sharing?
Yes, it also works with federated sharing because the chassis is a shared platform, so we have to set it. So this should also work from federated shares. So, as I said, we want to continue to make it easier to find people, and one concept we think about here, we already start to work on. Is that we want to create some kind of profile page with more consultants where we can have much more information about which I've been unfortunately seen to be on the screen here. But where you can have much more information than just your username, your password, and your government. But you can also share your phone number, your address, your maybe Twitter ID, your home page, and stuff. And just enter there. And then we can via drop down. Decide who can read this data. By default, it's only not external, it's only not personal profile. Then you can say, okay, it should be shared internally across the other users of the Nextcloud, or you want to have it public. And it's public, then you want to publish this on an external server where then people can find you. And you want to think about using the stuff like the Twitter ID or the web page to identify this, to create something like a momentum key page or something. So that you can make sure that people who are sending this Twitter account are really the same people, or at least own the Twitter account or own access to the Twitter account, to get some kind of certainty that it's the people you want to share. So let's see.
Why not email?
What?
Why not email?
What?
Why not email?
Email, of course, yes. I didn't say it, but it's also a screenshot. Of course, also email address and all the typical stuff people
have. It's very fine.
Yes, you can also use email address.
Of course,
we want people, yes, of course, we want people to have multiple stuff that you can verify. You can verify an email, then you have a page, Twitter, and then you can then look, then your next step can ask the lookup server for a special person, and then you see which accounts from this person are verified. So then you see, okay, this home page is email address and Twitter account, whatever is verified, and then can get some certainty that it's really the person I want to share with. So what you want to create here is basically a global address book, similar to what we know from forum books already, which exists for ages, but people can opt in, after, of course it's always opt-in because it's also a private thing, upload the data they want to, if they want to get that, if you want to, people can find them easier and then share it. So that you can have any name to share there, and you can query the lookup server and say, hey, maybe it's this person who wants to share it, and you can share it with this person without knowing the federated cloud ID. So that was from my side. Thank you, everybody. And if you still have some questions, I'm happy to answer them.
We thought about where to hope this century page.
That's still a little bit up to discussion. How they're hosted, if we hosted it, we also have many partners who are interested in hosting. DNS is also, there's also something to discuss for the region to use DNS to produce it.
There's no idea about
that.
What can do with having good information?
That's still a really up to discussion already. So if you have ideas, you can bring them. Of course, one group already have the first version, and maybe next about that, the first proof of concept or kind of product game where people already can try it out. But this is something we are sure that there's a lot of improvements here. And also this central service that we should talk in life. At least we would have like something like PGP or something, where we can have multiple services which sync somehow. But then we have other problems because how to make sure that the right person can update the same time on some of the server gets in. So there's still a lot of problems we need to solve. We want to start easy. Just to explore the idea to see how it works, how people use it, and then of course come down with DNS and records to somehow communicate directly. There are many ideas now. There's also something that many areas are really value for input and discuss the stuff with us and have great ideas. That's always appreciated.
We're planning to enhance this feature like B-sides, monetization service. For two users that would like to change the folders and all this, keep online.
And then sync them between the servers. That's something to think about every few months or years. This idea can come from someone, of course. It's at the moment, we always shy a little bit away from it because as soon as you start to sync between servers, you have all the problems. Also, solve a sync client, so a sync conflict, so you have all the stuff you need to solve somehow. But yeah, it's an idea which pops up every now and then, and you think about it, and maybe at some point in time you can have something else, but not yet directly or something.
You talked a little bit about global address book. Are these address books user-centric, or are they? What's the concept?
Yeah, that's what I said. I think our idea is to start with somehow a central server. The people that can decide that I publish my information in the central server. Similar to a regular phone book, I know in Germany we have the Deutsche Telekom. You can say, okay, I tell them my name and my address and my phone number. And then they publish this nice yellow books where people can find me. And this is the first and simple idea. We have the central server where people can say, okay, I want that people find me, I want that people share me, I share this and that information to the server. But then, as I said to you, of course, it's the first step, then we want to explore this bridge further. We don't want to send the server to at least something, just do it or something. Maybe there are completely different technologies like the nice one or something where we can put people to publish this information. That's a starting point, and then we see how people use it and how they evaluate this information.
Okay,
sounds good. Okay, thank you. I have all those who are in this talk.